Good afternoon, members. It is time to start the meeting. We have also formed a quorum, so I call the meeting to order. Well, we'll continue to use the request to speak system. So after you've taken your seat, please remain in your seat and don't go to other seats. Well, since the last meeting held on the 31st of January 2023, we have issued an information paper as set out in the agenda. Item 2 on the agenda. Items for discussion at the next meeting. So just want to inform members that together with the Deputy Chairman, on the 13th of February this year, we met with the Secretary for Development as well as her colleagues. It was a work plan meeting. In the light of the discussion on that day, the Secretariat has already added items proposed by the administration to our list of outstanding items for discussion, as well as proposals from members. So please note that the proposed timetable may change in the light of the latest developments concerning the relevant items. We have already included some indicated sort of we have indicated the possible dates for discussion. Please note the list of outstanding items for discussion. Well, for the next meeting, which will be held on the 28th of March, for that regular meeting, for the items for discussion, there are three proposals. First of all, proposed creation of three supernumerary directorate posts in the Development Bureau to take forward the work of the Northern Metropolis Coordination Office, and one supernumerary directorate post in the Civil Engineering and Development Department to assist in taking forward relevant land development projects in the Northern Metropolis. The second one is a public works program item number 771CL, site formation and infrastructure works for the development of ex-charcoaling coaling mine site phase 2, and PWP item number 7849CL, site formation and infrastructure works for public housing development at charcoaling village Kowloon East. The third item being review of the protection of the harbour ordinance cap 531. Members, would you agree to the proposed items? If there's no objection, I would say that they will be included in our agenda for the next meeting. All right. Item 3 then, PWP item number 767CL. Planning and engineering study for Lung Kwu Tan reclamation and the replanning of Tuen Mun West area. Please invite the relevant public officers to join us. For this item, it involves a funding proposal. So members, please note that in accordance with Rule 83A of the Rules of Procedures, if a member would like to speak in relation to an item that he or she has direct or indirect pecuniary interest, that member can only speak after disclosing the nature of the interest. For members who would like to ask questions, please press the request to speak button. First of all, I would like to welcome Ms. Benedict Lin, Secretary for Development, as well as her team of colleagues. I understand that the administration will start with a briefing, and you are going to make use of the PowerPoint, right? Over to you, Secretary. Thank you, Chair. Chair, maybe I can start with some opening remarks. Land formation is in fact going to be the subject matter of many more papers to come. For the Lung Kwu Tan reclamation and the replanning of the Tuen Mun West area, where in fact they are on our list of land formation. For the 2030 plus study, the report of which was published a few years ago, between now and 2048, for land for housing, for economic needs, for community development, etc., we need land to cope with the demand. And on our list, we have the Lung Kwu Tan reclamation as well as Tuen Mun West area. In today's paper, we are saying that for our study, altogether, 380 hectares of land will be involved, out of which we very much hope that for the first batch of land, in particular the reclaimed land in the vicinity of Lung Kwu Tan, will be ready in the year 2030-2031. Well, for the 380 hectares of land, it is hoped that 30% of the land will be available as developable land in the next 10 years. And in fact, half a year ago, we have also issued a report concerning our 10-year land supply. For Lung Kwu Tan, well, it occupies a strategic position. Well, if you care to turn to the map attached to our paper, it has a marine sort of location, and therefore, if we need marine access for certain industries, it will be of great advantage. And then to the south, we have the airport city. To the north, we have Qianhai or Shenzhen. In other words, this area can allow us to have a coastal economic belt in the western part of Hong Kong, in the western part of Shenzhen. And for the river trade terminal in TM West, its usage has always been on the low side, all the time being 20% or 25%. In other words, there is justification for us to take a fresh look and replan the land uses of this particular site. In addition, in recent years, we have newly completed roads and planned roads, which will mean that in the western part of Hong Kong, the accessibility will be hugely improved. Say, for example, Chatlock Kok Tuen Mun Link, which means that we are very accessible to the airport, linking up Lung Kwu Tan and the airport. And for the planned Route 11, as well as the planned Tuen Mun Bypass, again, we are going to connect with the Northern Metropolis, Hung Shui Kiu, Ha Tsuen, etc. The journey will be short. And then for the Kau Yee Chau artificial islands, there will be trunk roads as well as rail links to connect with this part of the city. In other words, you can see how strategic the location is like. On this occasion, we propose to have a study. There are a few salient points which we're going to repeat in a moment. But then I just want to say that there is some difference in the for the first point. In relation to the waterfront of Lung Kwu Tan, we are going to scale down the reclamation. My colleague will say more about that. And then on this particular slide, you can see that for the blue part of the photograph, we would like to have industrial developments there, taking into account the marine access as well as its strategic importance as a coastal economic belt. And then maybe you can refer to the second bullet point of the slide. For the blue area, we would like to have it available for industrial development directly, which is different from our idea a few years back. At that time, we thought that for the so-called heavy industrial uses, the steel mill, the fuel tanks, etc., in the darker blue area, were supposed to be relocated to the blue area reclaimed. Well, for us to relocate the facilities there, it will be disturbing and it will add to the time taken to have the newly formed land available for use. In other words, we are saying that we will make use of the newly reclaimed land directly, so that in 2030-2031 we'll be getting the first batch of developable sites for our economic needs. And then for the river trade terminal included in the TM West area, when we engage a consultant, we'll ask the consultant to focus on residential development. This is because it can be regarded as an extension of the Tuen Mun Tang Center. We also need residential development to provide housing so as to support the economic development. But of course, we'll ask the consultant not to forget one point. That is, the airport city is to the south of this area, and we can consider uses that can dovetail the development of the airport city. Another point is that we want to take this opportunity while we're farming land by way of reclamation and replanting TM West, we would like to enhance the accessibility of this part of the city. I would defer to my colleague to walk you through the paper. Who will walk us through the paper? Mr. Chong. Let me start with Chong Lung Kwu Tan. We believe that we can come up with 210 hectares of land, like 145 as indicated in blue, which is the nearshore reclamation at the northern side of Lung Kwu Tan, as well as 65 hectares of land near Lung Kwu Tan village, mainly used as brownfields now. Now, by having this reclamation approach, we can preserve the existing natural beaches as well as the shorelines. We can minimize the impacts of development on existing residents. We will explore the feasibility of building new roads within the reclamation to provide an alternative so as to avoid making all traffic go through the Lung Kwu Tan road in front of Lung Kwu Tan village. For our initial ideas, for the majority of the newly formed land at Lung Kwu Tan will be used to support the development of modern and advanced industries, in particular those requiring marine access and a large extent of operational space, like a modern logistics park, advanced construction industry park, high-end green technology industry park, as well as multi-story buildings for modern industries for the purpose of consolidating the brownfield operations. And there will be residential developments as well as community facilities as well. For Tuen Mun West area, our proposal is to have a replanning. Altogether, 175 hectares of land will be covered. There are four major elements. First of all, around 65 hectares of land in relation to the river trade terminal. And then for the river trade terminal basin, we can consider reclaiming 40 hectares of land. And then for areas 40, 46, 47, there will be altogether 38 hectares of land. Currently, they're being used as sewage plants, government facilities, cement plants, etc. And then finally, we can look at Tuen Mun Area 38, which can yield 32 hectares of land. Currently, this is being used as a temporary public field bank and temporary construction waste sorting facility. Just now, I talked about four portions, and then it will be mainly residential oriented. It will be regarded as an extension of the Tuen Mun community. It is very near to the Tuen Mun Chalap Kok link. We can consider using some of the land for logistics related uses so as to have synergy with the airport. Just now, I also said that for Tuen Mun West, for areas 38 and 49, as the secretary has said, we propose the retention of such facilities. For the temporary public field bank as well as the temporary construction waste sorting facilities on area 38, once they have been sort of removed, this area will become a buffer area, shielding the residential developments from the river trade terminal site. Now a word on the transport links. As I have said, for the Lung Kwu Tan reclamation, there will be new roads, and there we would like to widen the Lung Mun road so as to meet with the growth in the transport demand. And then externally, we would consider the connectivity between existing and planned road and railway networks, including the proposed Route 11, proposed Tuen Mun bypass extending Hong Kong Island with Hong Shui Kiu Rail Link proposed under the Kao Yi Chao Artificial Islands to Tuen Mun West, as well as the proposed improvements to Nim Wan North and Lim Wan South roads. It is believed that for the entire project, we would need $179 million.
It will comprise three major elements. The first one is about the planning and the engineering study. The second one is about the transport and other infrastructures. The last one is about the site investigation. This is the end of my presentation. Thank you. So, time for members' questions. Members who have raised their hands for questions are 8 in total. So, in sequence, Mr. Michael Tan, Mr. Stephen Ho, Mr. Lau Kok Fun, Mr. Andrew Lam, Ms. Chen Yit Ming, Mr. Frankie Yip, Mr. Kenneth Lau, and Mr. Holden Chow. First, Mr. Michael Tan, 4 minutes, please. Thank you, Chairman. First of all, I would like to thank the Development Bureau for taking into account views of the public. They have done some major alterations. This is a very comprehensive map. This is the map that we looked at back in 2020 in the same panel meeting. At that time, we proposed to reduce the reclamation area and we want to retain the beaches. The map at the bottom is the map from the administration, which is attached to this paper. So I thank you very much for making all the changes. At that time, we suggested that there should be a cross river bridge so that the heavy vehicles can go into the new industrial area. As you may be aware, the Lung Kwu Tan road is mainly used by private vehicles and heavy vehicles, and they are not welcoming to the residents nearby. So they hope that there will be a designated road which have bypassed the beach to go into the new development area. But that road is not stated in the map, but you have stated in the paper that apparently there will be a new road within the area. So I don't understand why don't you put the alignment on the map. If you have a map in this blue area, are you sort of crossing the water area? So if you are thinking along the same line as me, I thank you. The second one is about the reclamation in central waters. I fully support that. One of the reasons is that actually since 2014, I have been pressing for the fifth cross-harbour tunnel, and it will bypass Siu Lam and the artificial island to Hong Kong Island. It will relieve the traffic congestion at the railway for the Tuen Mun residents. The administration at this time agreed to that, but now I think you have changed everything. I have objected to this in different areas. You have said that the alignment is still there, but it has just been changed a bit. Today you are coming for funding support, and you are now saying that you will try to replant Tuen Mun West area. But I know that these studies will last for several years, and then there may be objections from the locals. So I think that will take a long time, and I don't see any delight of the tunnel. So if you want to include the Tuen Mun West rail extension in this project rather than the Central Waters project, then Secretary, I hope that you can give me an undertaking. No matter what will happen to the Lung Kwu Tan project, then you will also press ahead with the Tuen Mun West rail link. So that is before the completion of the fifth cross harbour tunnel, you will have a route going through the beach and to the Siu Lam area. Because I think this is the main area for taking into account the transport needs of the 500,000 population there. So Secretary, can you give me an undertaking here and now on this rail link? Thank you, Mr. Tin, for supporting the reduction of the reclamation in Lung Kwu Tan area, in front of the beach area. Mr. Stan Tan has pointed out that for the proposed reclamation, we will have a new proposed road. This is now pointed out by my colleagues. So since this is a new road to be built on the reclaimed land, so it has to be connected to the Tuen Mun West area on land. So if you look at Annex 2 of the paper, you can see that we have a dotted line there, which is connected to the Tuen Mun West area. That's the alignment that we've been thinking maybe there should be sort of an undersea section, but the technical areas and the alignments are under study. The final question of Mr. Tan about the rail link. For the railway extension, I think maybe it's easier to explain the situation with this map. If we try to look at the situation in KYC, artificial island, we are looking at the blue area. That is the alignment of the rail link. Our suggestion is that the alignment will go to the Tuen Mun East area, the blue line there. And under this study, for the current proposal at hand, we'll try to see how we can move from this blue circle to have an extension all the way going to the Tuen Mun West area. I understand Mr. Tan's concern. He's concerned that the RTT area will be a new development area. If the blue circle in Tuen Mun East, it is actually the final destination of the Tuen Mun South extension. There are already some residential blocks there. He's asking whether we can expedite the works. He's asking us not to await the Tuen Mun West study proposal. So I'll try to see if we can take that into account by phases. So this is my response to your third concern. Secretary, you're really very clever. Mr. Tan, maybe you let the Secretary finish first. Chairman, we are now coming to this panel about the Lung Kwu Tan and the Tuen Mun West area proposal. We're hoping that we can use 50 months to complete the project by phases. And we hope that for the first batch of reclaimed land, it will be available. We will start work on 2027, and by 2030 to 2031, the first batch of reclaimed land will be made available. So this is the rough timing that we're looking at. For Mr. Tan's question about the western extension for the Tuen Mun West area as to whether that can be completed by phases, we'll take that into account during our study and we'll come back with more concrete timetables. Next, Mr. Stephen Ho.
Thank you, Chair. Secretary, I think I often attend the development panel meetings and you're now seeking funding for a study. You are asking for $179 million for a P&E study. I'm not objecting to your proposal, but I would like to impose some conditions and hope that we can have sustainable development of our fishery industries. Well, for the introduction by the Secretary, it is stated that we have a very valuable shoreline area and we have to focus on our modern industries. Well, I think we are also trying to have high-quality ocean economic development. But for the fishermen who are being affected, it is not just by this project, but also the artificial islands, they may be affected. And the government has said that maybe the fishermen can sort of change their operations and work on the fishermen's wharf instead. But I think that would take a long time to do so. Well, I'm trying to look at the river trade terminal area, Area 37 and 38. You are saying that you will try to construct some residential or economic belts related to the airport. But across that, it is close to the Sha Chau Park. And I think we can turn it into a leisurely fishery industry. So the fishermen can collaborate with other sectors. For example, they can work on activities like yachting, or maybe they can have some catering or food retail shops. I think that will provide new economic opportunities for the fishermen to change their operation. For example, in Zhuhai and Samcheon, for the reports in the mainland, it is stated that it will be turned into a major transaction platform for the mainland, and they will make use of the Guangzhou Macau Bridge as well. Also, we could propose tourism, ecotourism. If we look at the map, if you use a search engine, you can see that for the yacht club, it is located on the eastern part of Zhuhai and Shenzhen. It is actually very close to us. There are about 700 yacht clubs there, and also for leisure fishing. But for Hong Kong, I think it is not possible to do so because the closest fishery market is in Castle Peak. So it is not for tourists, but for the fishermen to have trading there. So I think for this new piece of land, perhaps you can include this new element so as to resolve some of the conflicts for society. Can you talk a bit more about marine economy? We have criticized the government to say that you do the reclamation first and then you think about what to do with it. I've been cheated by the two former terms of government. But then after the reclamation, the piece of land has been used for other purposes. That's why I object to that. That's why I want to ask you now, in the initial stage, can you put into this idea, include that in the reclamation project? Secretary, would the modern industries be able to address the concern of Mr. Ho for the leisure fishing? Well, Chairman, we won't be reclaiming the land first and then think about the land use. During the study stage, we already have set out a positioning so that we can give the consultants and also government departments ourselves as to what we want to do. So I must say that for this study, we have not included yacht clubs and leisure fishing yet. But this time we have come to the development panel and we would like to listen to members' views so that when we work with the consultant, we can give them more specific directions. If I may supplement, the River Trade Terminal is now close to the airport city. The airport authority actually would like to have some fishery or yachting activities in the airport proximity areas. So we will work with the Hong Kong Airport Authority to see how we can arrive at some synergy and so that we can incorporate these elements in the consultancy study. So we will try to address Mr. Ho's need. Well, Airport Authority is a good organization, but I'm afraid that you just pass the project to the Airport Authority and then they will just gain all the economic benefits. I was a part of the Airport Authority as well, but I think for the fishermen who have been affected by this project, I do think that they can collaborate with the Airport Authority. So please don't shut them out and don't just go for tender so that only the major companies can win the bids. And then you are just left with fishermen who cannot benefit. So I hope the government will be more proactive in this respect. Next, Mr. Lau Kwok Fun. Chairman, I support the Lung Kwu Tan reclamation and the replanning of Tuen Mun West area. Lung Kwu Tan actually has a very good position. It is within the Bay Area. It is close in the middle of the Hong Kong Airport and the Chin Hoi Airport. And it is close to Lau Fau San and Chin Bei Jai as well. So the development of this area will be beneficial to the economy of Hong Kong and the northern part of Hong Kong. For the current proposal, I think it has balanced the interests of the various stakeholders, including the villagers, and you are reducing the area of reclamation. So I would like to know, with the reduced reclamation extent, would it still be sufficient for our industries to develop? So apart from reclamation, would you think of other measures, like, for example, using rock cavings? And will you do some study in that respect? For the northern metropolis, I think for the Park Lai area, Lau Fau San and Chin Bei Jai, there have been studies and there will be studies. For this area, it is just separated by Lim Wan Road. So I would like to know for the Lung Kwu Tan study, will you take into account the area of Park Lai and Chin Bei Jai? so that you look at the area holistically. Or you may incorporate this area into the northern metropolis as well. I think these are all possible options, so this is the first point. Secondly, on the timetable, you're going to use 30 months and you're going to do it by phases. I would like to know whether the timetable can be further compressed. For the new towns in Takuling, you only have a study which will last about 36 months, and that project is much bigger than this. I think Lung Kwu Tan is a much smaller area, but you still need 30 months to do so. So can you compress the timetable? For the Shen Tin Lok Ma Chau area, the planning and the detailed design can actually be taken forward simultaneously.
If you say that you can't cut short the time needed in this particular area, can you not have the planning as well as the detailed design being carried out in parallel? Secretary, in a moment, I would like to invite the Director of Planning to address the point made by Mr. Lau, Shang Bak Lai, Ha Bak Lai, and Jin Bak Bei Zhui. I think he will update you on the progress of the study. The member mentioned that we have scaled down the reclamation at Lung Kwu Tan. This is mainly because we considered that we have got a very beautiful beach and a natural coastline. So for reclamation, I think it has to be justified. Yes, there will be a smaller reclamation area, but then there will be brownfield sites to be included in the study as well. If the consultant is to suggest that we need more land, I'm sure there's room for making certain suggestions of such a nature. Well, we do intend to complete the study in 13 months' time over a number of phases. Now, assuming that we can start the study in the second half of the year, and for the first batch of developable land to be available, it will take us 7 years. As we have already said many times, if we try to compress the time taken to have land available for development, we can have it done in 7 years instead of 10 years. We aren't just going to have paperwork. We need environmental impact assessments, and we need to go through the statutory process as well. So we'll try our best to complete the statutory process that is mandatory. Can I defer to the Director of Planning? Yes, Mr. Chung, please be brief. In relation to the Jin Bei Zhui, Bak Lai and Lau Fau San study, as part of the Northern Metropolis study, it was started last year. Progress is good. We hope that we can come up with certain initial recommendations. For the relationship between that study and the Lung Kwu Tan study, there may very well be two different consultants, but then there is an internal dialogue between the two teams, and we will we can make sure that the entire region will be taken as an integrated whole. Next, Mr. Andrew Lam. Reclamation, land formation, etc. have always got my support. However, when it comes to land formation for Hong Kong as a whole, well, for a period of time, the Hong Kong government has been looking at the land supply, in particular land supply for housing. I'll come to my first question. I want to know, just now, the Secretary told us that for the time being, it is hoped that the consultants will look at the residential developments, while at the same time, you will try to explore whether there are suitable economic uses as well. I need to share with you my concern. To the north, we have the firing range, and then in the vicinity, I won't call them offensive uses, but certainly the operations are in conflict with residential developments. Say, for example, for the proposed reclamation for Area 132 of Chang Kwan O. existing residents are opposing the idea. Here, we don't yet have any residents, but I'm afraid that there will be conflicts in future. Now, if land is available for Hong Kong as a whole, then for this particular site, I would rather have modern logistics industries being developed. You talk about 140 hectares of land, and then decisions have been made about the future uses of brownfield sites. So the relevant industries will be hugely impacted upon. So here, if you can come up with short-term, medium-term, and long-term solutions, in particular when transport will be enhanced here, then I would say that such an arrangement will be better. I come to my second point, and that's in relation to the local consultation. In paragraph 10 of your paper, it is said that soon you're going to go to the Tuen Mun District Council, the rural area, as well as the villages and representatives of Lung Kwu Tan Village. I wonder if you are able to present to us the views of the local people before the paper is up for PWSC discussion. Secretary, well, for Tuen Mun West, and its replanning as to the ratio between residential and non-residential uses, Mr. Lam's observation is noted. If I may share with you my view, currently we have got the third runway of the airport, so this area will be subject to a height restriction. We can't actually have dense development for residential purposes. It will be low rise, but of course not. So we're not having the same like in the case of Fanning North, where we can develop high rise buildings for people to live in. But still, we believe that together with the industrial developments at Lung Kwu Tan, we believe that there is still a need for housing. And once the public field bank has been relocated, there will be a buffer for any possible residential developments here. But of course, another option will be to have uses that are more related to the airport city. We do have an open mind. We don't want to sort of rule out the possibility of residential development. You need people to support the industrial developments, so you need housing, land. We are still hoping that when we come back to ask the FC for approval, we can sort of tell you more about the brief for the consultants. We will have an initial round of consultation with the district council, local people, etc. Before we go to the FC. As to a larger scale public consultation, I think that's more likely to take place after we have got some initial recommendations. Mr. Chairman, I think we need housing in the same area so as to support the industrial developments. But then we won't be, and we shouldn't be talking about low-rise buildings that would not be what the market would expect. Noted. Ms. Chen. Thank you, Chair. $179 million are being asked for to carry out a P&E study for Lung Kwu Tan reclamation and the replanning of Tuen Mun West. It has my support. Well, broadly speaking, we have Shenzhen on the other side, which will have high quality development. And then we have got Lanshan and Bao'an and Shenzhen, as well as the other new development areas in Hong Kong. I did go to Lung Kwu Tan. I could clearly see Shekou on the other side of the boundary. But then at Zhengzhou, we have the sludge treatment plant. We have also got the columbarium, and there will be another sort of incineration plant. Yes, it is said that the area will mainly be for modern industrial developments. and there will be a modern logistic park. I hope the administration would note my observation. First of all, we have got the incineration plant, landfill, as well as the columbarium. How do they sort of relate with the modern logistics park? Please pay attention to the interfacing. And then for the river trade terminal, the site is some distance from the other facilities like the landfill, the incineration plant, etc. But it is still within the same Tuen Mun District Council area. Make sure that the Tuen Mun West residents won't be affected by such facilities. We don't want to repeat the problems that the Chang Kwan O residents are facing. And then at the last environmental affairs panel, I think you need to consider the same concern here. That is, in Tuen Mun West, there may be some heritage issues, and there may be a key. There may be some historic sites or some monuments, so make sure that you will take care of that as well. Secretary, to give a brief answer to Ms. Chen's question, for the reclamation of Lung Kwu Tan, what we want to do is as follows. We will make good use of the power plant there as well as the small hill at Lim Wan. They can sort of act as a buffer. But of course, we have to wait until the detailed design stage before we can have a better idea. The purpose, of course, is that the area for industrial users will be sufficiently sealed off from the other users. And for the replanting of Tuen Mun West, well, I think it is some distance from the other facilities that you mentioned. We'll make sure that there will be a sufficient buffer. Ms. Chen also urged us to make sure that we will look at the heritage side of the matter. That point will be noted. Any other questions? No. Next, Mr. Frankie Yick. I think the Secretary would recall that during the days of Donald Zhang's era, areas 38 and 46 and 40 of Tuen Mun were supposed to be used for logistics industry development. Now you're going to resume land there, and then it will be used for multi-story industrial buildings. It is said that open storage land is inadequate. The former Secretary for Development has always promised to give more land to the logistics industry when reclamation at Lung Kwu Tan is ready. So you are honoring your promise, though it comes late, but they still have my support, as it is located near to the Hong Kong-Shenzhen link. For the River Trade Terminal, I think as Andrew has rightly pointed out, for Area 38, I think it's better for us to have it for air cargo, as it is near to the airport by making use of the Tuen Mun Chalakot link. And then on the right-hand side, if you do have residential developments, then this will act as a buffer. It's better. For the eco park on the other side, well, we have to be honest, it does emit certain odor, which is not welcoming. And it is good to keep the scenery of Lung Kwu Tan. I know you are shifting northwards the reclamation. I have told you many times, Madam Chair, I think we need to look at the question of berths. They would be useful for loading and unloading purposes, as well as ship repairing. And then we have prefabricated manufacturing plants, and they need piers and berths to have a marine access. They also rely on heavy machinery as well. I think this is the first time that I read in a government paper that you're going to develop a modern logistics park. I hope it is similar to the industrial estate or the science and technology parks that we have got in Hong Kong. that is, applicants can apply for a site, and then the applicant builds his or her own building, or the government can come up with a ready-to-use facility. Let's hope that we can sort of move towards the construction of a modern logistics park. So you have my support, and I hope that you will proceed as early as possible. Now, others may say that reclamation will bring about marine pollution. Just yesterday, I told a reporter that is the modern-day reclamation methods are very different from the previous ones. It will be environmentally friendly and there won't be any problems with sludge.
Secretary, well, first of all, I would like to thank Mr. Yik for his support. He talked about the modern logistics park and the other high-end green technology industry park and also advanced construction industry park. So when the reclaimed land is available, we will try to earmark the land for these purposes. And this is an issue of operation. And then, of course, there may be different options. And I think we can be more diversified. So we will deal with that at a later stage. Mr. Yik has also pointed out that if we're going to replan Tuen Mun West area, it will be an extension of the Tuen Mun area. And we talk about Area 38. We hope that it will be used as a buffer zone. Mr. Yik has pointed out that this buffer zone can actually be a logistics use for logistics use. And we will take that into account and we'll ask the consultant to look into that. Next, Mr. Kenneth Lau. Chairman, well, first of all, I welcome the administration for reducing the reclamation near Lung Kwu Tan. We have been fighting for that for some 40 years. This is the demand of the villagers. So this is something very positive for them. And it reflects that this term of government is actually receptive to the citizens' views. On the reclaimed area, it will be reduced to about 145 hectares, mostly in the northern area, which is further away from the Lung Kwu Tan village. But I see that some of the reclamation area are actually close to the burial grounds. So I hope the government would have some minor alterations so as you will not put up any barriers for the burial ground and affect the feng shui of the area. Well, I must declare that I am a representative of the villagers of Lung Kwu Tan village, and I have some pieces of land there. I have a question in paragraph 6A. It is stated that about 65 hectares of land are now mainly used for brownfields and will be incorporated into the study and will be planned holistically with the reclaimed area. So I would like to know what criteria would you use for picking these 65 hectares of land? Are they all government land? If you put in new zoning and new uses, there is now an absence of an OZP. So would it affect the operations of the landowners there? If the 65 hectares of land have to be used for public services, would you be resuming land there? And you will force the owners to move away or change the land use. Would that be the case? Secretary, we try to include the 65 hectares of land mainly because they are now used for brownfield site operations, for open-air operations, and they are incongruent with the current use. But for the other area, they are mostly hill slopes. So we choose them because they are incongruent with the current environment and they are brownfield operations. According to our initial study, if you look at the northern part of the Lung Kwu Tan reclamation, kind of the purple patches on the map, you can see that they are mostly owned by private owners. As always, when we go ahead with planning, we need to consider how to deal with private land. And there are several ways that we can go about it. First, of course, we can resume the land and to try to achieve our planning purpose. Secondly, if the owners of these pieces of private land they would like to have development after rezoning, then I think this is a market force. So we haven't really made up our minds yet, but we will try to see what will be the planning purpose and we'll decide at a later stage. A follow-up. Currently, if the landowners have some ideas of development and you are now going to do a 30-month study, so according to the past experience, this 30-month period will be kind of like a frozen period. So you just freeze the ideas of the landowners. And also you are going to amend the legislation and you want to do things quicker and be more effective. So will you be affecting the idea of these private landowners, their way of developing their land? Well, when the government is commissioning a study, we will not sort of freeze the development projects of the private landowners. But for other areas, the situation is the same. If we have embarked on a study, and if the private landowner wants to have some kind of development, they may need to go to the town planning board for approval, or they may need to go to the lands department for changing the land lease. They have avenues for doing so. But when the government consider these applications, we would like to see whether their proposals will be contradicting our study or to lead to a situation that our study will not be able to achieve our purpose. For example, if we try to develop a large piece of land and the private landowner owns a piece of land in the middle of it and they have their own ideas, and if we go along with their idea, then the whole study will have to be sort of stopped. So we have to be careful if we come across such applications. But if their proposals are not in contradiction with our general planning direction, during the processing of the application, we will take that into account. So it is not a situation that we will freeze everything when we conduct a study. How about the burial grounds? Please try to minimize impact on that. Yes, Chair. We fully note that. We note that for the blue reclaimed area under Lung Kwu Tan, we understand that for to the north of it, there are some green areas. It is the area. That is the burial sites. And for our study, we will try to not to impact the burial sites of the indigenous villagers there. This is a very natural sort of landscape, and it can serve as a natural barrier. So during our study, we will also look into the elements of feng shui, etc. Secretary, I have a follow-up. Most of the time, when the government commission a study, or when they sort of process an application, there may be impact on your study. You just said that if the application falls in the middle of the government study, then it may be affected. Well, this study, we're talking about it, that it will last for about 30 months. For the stakeholders, if they are being affected, then the applications may need to be processed quickly, so that they will not be affected by your 30-month study. Because I think these private landowners want to tally with your study. That's why they want to have some planning applications. So if possible, please try to expedite the processing of such applications. And it will help the landowners, private landowners a lot. Actually, I have received a similar views from the industry that is similar to what Mr. Lau has said. And I hope the government will be sympathetic to them and to a certain extent try to help these private landowners to process their applications. Next, Mr. Holden Chow. Thank you. First of all, I'm glad that the government is receptive to the ideas of the villagers of Lung Kwu Tan and you have reduced the impact of the reclamation. So thanks for listening to the villagers. I have several suggestions concerning the reclamation. First, I hope that the reclaimed land will be mostly used for industries which will add value to the area and will create jobs for the area. then I think the reclamation is worthwhile. Why do I say so? Because in the past, the development of Lung Kwu Tan has been sort of lacking in the provision of a new road. So I hope that for the current reclamation, you will move in industries which will create economic benefits and create jobs for the area. And then for these high-value modern industries, they will create economic benefits, and you should provide a new road to connect Lung Kwu Tan with the other areas. And we don't just rely on Lung Kwu Tan road, because Lung Kwu Tan road is now more or less the only single trunk road, and it is up to capacity. For the paper, I see that you have a yellow line in the map, and you were saying that you hope to have a submerged road there, so to connect Lung Kwu Tan with the outside areas. So I hope that you will let us know clearly and precisely that there will be a new road connecting Lung Kwu Tan to other areas, and don't just rely on Lung Kwu Tan road. This is the most important point. For the industries which will bring about economic benefits, the administration is talking about modern logistics. And for Lung Kwu Tan, it is close to the airport, and you have the teleport Lung Kwu Tan Link Road, and there are also logistics parks there. I think you will be able to create jobs, and I think that is an area worth exploring. Also, I think you should take into account the needs of the fishermen, because they will be affected. So you should be able to give them some alternative development opportunities. I would like to thank Mr. Kenneth Lau. He has provided a lot of good ideas for me to liaise with the villagers of Lung Kwu Tan. For the fishermen, I think leisurely fishing is worth exploring. Also, yachting would also help generate tourism. And you may have some berths for the yachts. And I hope Lung Kwu Tan will be a possible area for developing such, because all these activities would help the fishermen so that they can have new opportunities and new jobs. So leisurely fishing, I hope it will be included in your study. And I hope that in future we'll be able to see such developments so that you will drive the development of tourism for that area and you will create jobs for the area as well. So these are my questions and comments. Thank you, Chairman. Secretary? Well, thank you, Mr. Chow. You have given us a very clear direction. It is actually the same as what we've been thinking. We hope that the industry will drive economic development and want to enhance transportation and connectivity with the other areas. And we hope that there will be an alternative route to alleviate traffic on Lung Kwu Tan Road. We will definitely do that. If we don't deliver on that, I don't think the residents there will accept it. Also, we would like to take this opportunity. We want to widen Lung Kwu Tan Road. And during the study, if there are other roads that comes into the picture, we'll see whether we have the chance to enhance them. For the development of the industries, well, leisurely fishing is a suggestion. Please let us look into that, and we'll see whether we can take that and the replanning of Tuen Mun West area into account holistically. We'll see whether we can take the opportunity to provide such. So maybe we won't be putting that in Lung Kwu Tan, but we'll try to look at the whole area holistically to see which will be the best place for accommodating such industries. Next, Ms. Wendy Hong. Thank you, Chairman. For the Lung Kwu Tan and Tuen Mun West area, it has been accommodating a lot of heavy industries, like cement plants, steel plants, etc., and also power stations. These industries are actually important for the development of Hong Kong. These are basic infrastructures. For the reclaimed area in Lung Kwu Tan, it has been proposed for some 10 years. Back in 2011, this area has been picked for reclamation, and funds has been set aside for several studies. But right now, we are still talking about a study. But for the heavy industries in this area, I think they are facing uncertainty. For example, there is a company in that area. They have approached me. They say they want to buy some machinery, and they want to have new development and new industries. But because the study affects their land, so they may have to be relocated. So that's why they are facing a lot of uncertainty, and they are not willing to invest into new development. So now you are going to have a P&E study. I would like to know whether you can let the companies and the operations know that they will be affected, and which ones will not be affected. Can you work out such a list before you commence the 30-month study? I think you may be aware that some factories or some operations will not be touched and will not need to be relocated. If such a list can be compiled, then I think the operations concerned can press ahead with their own strategies and development plans. So this is point number one.
My second point is that I do agree with what others have said, that is, on this occasion, we should ride on the opportunity to resolve the existing problems faced by Tuen Mun West and Lung Kwu Tan residents, like lack of industrial development. I think we need to take a broader view and try to use this occasion to solve the territory-wide problems. We have got a steel mill, and upstream, we have got scrap metal collectors. They're usually very small in size, and they're spread across the territory. And they are of a lower efficiency, and they are causing pollution. Can we not take this opportunity to pull together the recyclers, and we should have them located next to a waterfront? We can enhance the efficiency of land use, and it will facilitate our regulatory work. And then for heavy industries, there will be a better synergy between the upstream and downstream operations. I will just ask the two questions first. Secretary, thank you, Chair. Now, we have set out the scope of the study, and this is different from the earlier one a few years back. We did say that we don't want to have to relocate those facilities within the green boundary. My colleague is pointing to the facilities there. A few years back, we were sort of really ambitious. We tried to suggest that such facilities should be relocated to the reclaimed site. It has caused them worry, and then for the air fuel storage, it is difficult to find a reception area. It will have an impact on our airport. And then for the relocation to take place, it will take time. It will hold up the progress. So on this occasion, we said from the beginning that we want to assure the relevant parties of our latest thinking. That is, they will not be affected. After the meeting, we will follow this up. Dr. Hong mentioned that for land reclaimed at Lung Kwu Tan, perhaps we can make use of the site for recycling industries. And in fact, there will be a few parks there, and we're talking about the Green Technology Park. And if it is related to the high-end Green Technology Industry Park, I think it is feasible. All right. Next, Mr. Lee Chan Kang. Thank you, Chair. In Hong Kong, if we want to have development, then we have to cut the slopes, we have to excavate the hills, we have to reclaim land from sea. I'm grateful to members who have spoken, including Mr. Kenneth Lau. I think we are seeing progress here. Dr. Wendy Hong and Mr. Houghton Chow also talked about the unavoidable conflicts and concerns. I share their views. I'm particularly concerned about infrastructure first. If you have ever driven your vehicle to Lung Kwu Tan, you will agree with me that the roads were dusty and the air was also sort of not of good quality. We have got the eco park, we have got the power generation plant, we have got the Tuen Mun Chat Lap Kok link. I think it's better for that area to be used for logistics industry as well as other industrial uses like marine-related or ship-related industries. I want to point out that the currents, the waves are rather strong off the coast. Even the coal ash has been causing a nuisance. Have you already carried out an impact study? So first, air pollution, second, the strong waves or the water currents there. I would like to defer to our expert, Director of Civil Engineering and Works, Mr. Fong. A few years back, I think between 2015-2017, we carried out an initial assessment in relation to the environmental impact, like the water currents, water quality, air quality, etc. At that time, there was an initial assessment. We believed that it would be sort of controllable. Of course, the upcoming P&E study will be even greater in depth as we have to meet the requirements for the EIA. As to the concerns raised by Mr. Lee, I can assure him that all of them will be adequately addressed. Thank you. Let me come to my question. Now, we would like to have high-quality industrial developments for traditional industries like the logistics industry. We still need it. For infrastructure first, I think we need roads and links. And then what about power supply? Are we going to accommodate the use of hydrogen as the fuel for power generation? So can you accommodate the new energy? Can you not have synergy with the GBA so that we can have R&D here and then we can use the GBA as a springboard and then we can approach the global market. Secretary, we are at the stage of land use proposals. We are yet to enter the stage of deciding on the details. Now, I can assure you that the government is determined to provide land for modern industries. We need to be innovative in our thinking. So I don't think we would be sort of conventional and try to auction off the land. Now, for green technology industry park, say for example, we really want to have the highest end green technologies. So how can we bring about that to happen? Probably at the time of land allocation, we need to provide incentives to attract the investors. Well, utilities would have to be addressed as well. And then existing industries will be affected. So I urge you to give priority to this so that they will sort of have the preparatory work completed first. All right, comments noted. Altogether, 10 members spoke. I just want to check with members as to whether you support the paper being referred to the PwC for their consideration. Any objection? No? Then we have your support. So the paper will be referred to the PwC. I'd like to thank the secretary as well as her team for answering members' questions. Next, we move on to item 4. Proposals to update drainage-related regulations under the Buildings Ordinance. please invite the appropriate officers to join us. For members who would like to speak, you may now press the request to speak button. I would like to welcome the representatives from the administration. I'll give the floor to the administration. I think there will be a PowerPoint presentation, right? Who will walk us through the slides? Yes, please. Ms. Choi, please. Thank you, Chair. Good afternoon, Chair. Good afternoon, members. The Development Bureau, as well as the Buildings Department, proposed to update the drainage-related regulations under the Buildings Ordinance. Well, we have already taken into account the recommendations of the consultants, as well as the latest development of our technology, as well as the social developments. Well, there are two main areas within our proposals. First of all, we would like to introduce performance-based standards instead of keeping the prescriptive requirements. In simple terms, what we are going to achieve is that under the new regulations, we try to avoid being exhaustive. Say, for example, specifying the number of pipes as well as the dimensions of the pipes. We'll try to have less details. On the contrary, we try to specify the performance that we are looking for, like being effective in the drainage. In this way, we are giving more flexibility to the designer. In the light of the changing needs of the society and the advancement of technology, we believe that this is a better approach. On the other hand, we want to enhance and update the standards for drainage and works. Well, we have had a few years of the pandemic, and then everybody is more concerned about hygiene and sanitation. Therefore, we are enhancing the requirements. Say, for example, we are going to mandate that for toilets and bathrooms, we must have a floor drain. And then for the trap, the water seal should be automatically replenished so as to prevent the loss of the water seal. And then for the in April 2021, the Buildings Department issued some practice notes, and some of the latest requirements have been implemented on an administrative basis so as to allow the industry to get familiar with them. Now, our proposal is to have it being sort of set out in the regulations. We also cover the distance between the accessible roof as well as the ventilation pipe. In our regulation, the existing regulations, it says not less than 1 meter. We want to have it enhanced to not less than 3 meters. It cannot be done without amending the regulations. There are also other new requirements or new standards. All of them aim at updating and improving the drainage standards. I would like to defer to my colleague, that is the Deputy Director of Buildings, to walk you through the paper. All of us would be trying our best to answer your questions. All right, thank you. Ms. Karen Chang, please. Thank you, Chair. Good afternoon. I would like to brief you on the proposals to update the drainage-related regulations under the Buildings Ordinance. For the existing regulations. They were enacted in 1959 to govern the planning, design and construction of plumbing and drainage systems in private buildings. Over the years, amendments or revisions have been carried out. We looked at the recommendations of the consultants. We looked at the advancement in technology. We came up with a comprehensive review. Now, we would like to have amendments in two areas. First of all, replacing the prescriptive requirements with performance-based standards. Second, we want to enhance and update the standards for the design and construction of the drainage systems. Under the existing regulations, it is prescriptive in nature.
It sets out, for example, the dimensions and the designs of equipment. For example, the number and the size of the pipes have been set out, and it is related to the area of a floor of roof. If it's about 100 meters square, then they need to use pipes of 100 millimeters. But for the new regulation, we will not set out the dimensions of the pipes, but the purpose and the intended effect of the pipes. So we would leave the detailed requirements to the new code to be drawn up, what we call the drainage code. So the code of practice for drainage in buildings will set out the detailed requirements in accordance with the performance-based standards. For example, if the designer can work according to the drainage code, they have an effective way of discharging storm water, then they can propose suggestions to do so and also alternative proposals. So this will allow greater flexibility for the design. And also because the drainage code is administrative in nature, so when there is new development and new technology, we can try to update the code in time as appropriate. The second area is that we want to enhance the design and the implementation of the discharge requirements. The first requirement is that we want to mandate the provision of a floor drain. Our suggestion is that we will mandate the provision of a floor drain with a suitable trap in every room, for example, a toilet and a bathroom. So the floor drain has to be equipped with a suitable trap. And then for the trap, it should be replenished automatically with used water so as to prevent loss of the water seal. So this map shows the automatic replenishment. So there is a pipe which provides used water automatically to the trap. So we will require such for lavatory basin, a bath or a shower bath. If the trap has sufficient water seal, then it can prevent the escape of foul air into the premises. Also, we want to enhance the design of the ventilation pipe so the foul air will not go back to the premises. So this is a ventilation pipe. It is a very important component of the plumbing system. The ventilation pipe actually covers the pressure to ensure the discharge of wastewater and soil water. Now the requirement is that this ventilation pipe should be no less than 1 meter higher than the roof, accessible roof. So the new requirement is that it has to be installed suitably so that the foul air will not flow back to the premises. Our suggestion is that the open end of a ventilation pipe should be increased from no less than 1 meter to no less than 3 meters away from an accessible roof. So the open end of the ventilation pipe also has to be away from wall opening and fresh air intake. Similarly, the distance will be no less than 3 meters between them. For the multi-story buildings, the lower floor areas may have time to time have backflow of foul water. So we want to enhance the design of the drainage system as well. Our suggestion is this ventilation stack. There should be cross ventilation on the drainage stack at different intervals. So there should be some connections between them. According to this map, you can see the cross ventilation areas. To prevent backflow for the lower floor areas, we will also require the separation of the pipework of the lower floor from the main drainage stack serving the upper floors, so as to reduce the risk of backflow of foul water on the lower floors caused by pressure fluctuation when the upper floors flush the toilet. At the same time, we would like to ban the use of some outdated designs. The public is concerned about open hoppers. You can see it in the map here. So these are open hoppers. So this open hopper requires regular maintenance. Under the new legislation, we will ban the use of open hopper, and we will only accept a closed system for the discharge of wastewater. Some facilities store foul water temporarily, like the latrine fitments, trough water closets, and cesspools. They do not meet modern hygiene standards, and we would like to ban their use. So you can see from the map, these are the old buildings. And this one is in Mei Ho Lau. So in the past, you can see that we use trough water closets, and these are not acceptable by modern day standards. Also, we propose some technical amendments, such as we want to align the provisions with the similar ones under the Water Works Ordinance. We'd also rationalize the provisions and phrases in the new regulation, like surface water, runoff water, subsoil water, and condensed from an air conditioner as storm water. Also, we will have consequential amendment to 14 pieces of subsidiary legislation to ensure consistency and coherence of the drainage-related requirements and cross-references in these different legislation. Well, for some of these new proposals and increased standards, actually, back in April 2021, we have promulgated them in the form of practice notes. It allows more time for the industry to familiarize themselves with the new requirements. The feedback from the industry has been positive. They have also provided with comments, and we have incorporated them into the refinements to the drainage code. Following the promulgation of the practice note, the industry has followed the new standards, and they will use the new designs for the opening of the ventilation pipes so that it will be further away from the accessible roof, and also they won't use open hoppers. But still, we need to amend the legislation accordingly. And we have consulted the relevant committees, and the committee members are in support of our proposals, and also the enhancement of the standards of the equipment. For way forward, we will try to draft the relevant legislative amendments and the new regulation. Our purpose is hope that by 2023 Q4, we will table them in the Legislative Council. And also, we will promulgate the drainage code so as to let the industry know about the relevant standards and technical specifications. Thank you, Ms. Zhang. Now it's time for members to speak. I have three members who would like to speak. Mr. Chen Hock Fong, Mr. Lee Chen Kong, and Mr. Andrew Lam. Mr. Chen, 4 minutes, please. Thank you, Chairman. After the fifth wave of the epidemic, I think people are concerned about the pipes and the drainages. They need to be enhanced so as to reduce the spread of viruses. But I think for the current proposal, we have to be clearer. We are now trying to use a performance-based requirements, rather a prescriptive requirement. If you have less detailed provisions, then there may be more debates or controversies. How are you going to define performance-based? Well, for the workers, it may be difficult to grasp. Well, in the past, you tell us, you know, how many pipes you need, the size of them, etc. But how are you going to implement performance-based standards? They are so vague. Well, after you have set the standard, how are you going to implement them? Do you have a timetable for implementation? Well, for the open hoppers, for the old buildings, they have a lot of them. If you're not going to push for the issue, after you have set the standard, it is still meaningless. So is the new, are the new standards only applicable to new buildings? How are you going to deal with the existing building, especially the old buildings? It is not stated in your paper. When you press ahead with the matter, the drainage system is quite costly for a building. So are you going to provide subsidies for the owners' corporation and the property owners? If not, after the amendment of the regulation, then it will be just meaningless. People will just think that nothing has happened. So the important point is, how are you going to implement it and take it forward? Director of Buildings, Ms. Yu. Well, thank you, Mr. Chen, for your questions. He has three questions. First, we are now trying to move from a prescriptive method to a performance-based method. It seems a bit unclear, but actually, this way of working is applied in other new pieces of legislation as well. For example, 2 years ago, when we tried to change the construction legislation, we adopt the same approach as well. So the main purpose is to set out the purpose of the legislation. For example, we will state that the pipelines have to be able to discharge sewage water properly. But of course, it is difficult to say what is effectively. That's why we need the drainage code. And the drainage code actually has incorporated comments and suggestions from the industry. It will be a very detailed requirement, setting out all the detailed requirements so that you don't have to use new technology or other ways to calculate the issues. But for these prescriptive methods, the good thing is that they are included in the drainage code. The good thing is that one can choose not to follow it. They will be deemed to be satisfied requirements for compliance with the standards. So you have to come up with an alternative solution. So that's why you may have to use applied technology, or you may have to do some math and calculations, because there may be new design for the pipes and new materials so that, for example, the wastewater can flow better. So if they can demonstrate to us, it will be acceptable. So there is flexibility. On implementation, for new legislation, generally, they will not apply to existing old buildings. But are there hygiene problems? I think during the pandemic, we have been paying particular attention to that, to see whether these draining pipes are means for spreading the virus. If they are being used and maintained properly, even if we use the current drainage systems and the current requirements, I think they are still hygienic and healthy, but we want to do better. So for the owners of the existing buildings, if they think that the open hoppers are not convenient, they need to be maintained regularly, and if they want to use something new, they are welcome to do so. And also we have a subsidy scheme for the drainage system. It has been set aside by the government, and $1 billion has been set aside for the purpose. So we are trying to help the old residential buildings. The owners of such can apply for some subsidy for upgrading their drainage system. Thank you, Director.
Next, Mr. Lee Chen Kang. Thank you, Chair. We have had the experience of SARS as well as the latest COVID pandemic. It is right for us to update our standards so as to move with the times, and then we can prevent the spread of infectious diseases. Now, you may very well revise the statutory requirements, but who has to comply with the requirements? It would be the owners, members of the owners' corporations, as well as the authorized persons. So it is a matter of enforcing the law, in particular for the so-called three new buildings. We've got many and old tenement buildings. So can you share with us how you're going to take this forward? And then for the backflow of foul air, I think your proposal is good, but then what about if space is limited? If there are such constraints, then can you come up with an alternative solution? Thank you, Director. Maybe you can tell us more about the situation concerning new and older buildings. Whenever we revise our laws, we would not ask the existing buildings to comply with the new requirements. That would be too intrusive. But then we do welcome efforts to comply with the revised standards. We don't have a plan to mandate compliance across the board. I have a question that, Mr. Lee, please wait for the director to answer the question. There's this building drainage system repair subsidy scheme. I think if you recall, in the early days of the pandemic, the administration funded the buildings department's effort to cover the external drainage system inspection in Hong Kong. At that time, the scheme was carried out and the scheme has now been completed. Well, for drainage systems, some of them are worn and torn. There was leakage, or there was a change to the system in such a way that it was not in compliance with the legal requirements. At the time, 18,000 buildings were inspected, 10,000 orders were issued, and we are enforcing them one after another. Most of the time, we are talking about individual flats. When they carry out, when owners carry out the repairs so as to address the problems like seepage and leakage, I think they can try to bear in mind the new requirements. And under the Building Drainage System Repair Subsidy Scheme, they can apply for a subsidy. Well, in fact, under the scheme, the Buildings Department worked together with the Urban Renewal Authority, hoping that we can help 3,000 buildings. For the buildings department, we'll try to cover 1,500 of them. We'll try to do it for them. As it has been pointed out, there are three new buildings. Their drainage systems are broken, but then the owners are not able to do it themselves. So we will go there to carry out the work for them, and then we will ask the owners to refund our costs after deducting the subsidy that they are entitled to. So we will try to help them to meet the new requirements. Well, in Hong Kong, for our buildings, we need to carry out mandatory maintenance. Can we not have it incorporated as part of the mandatory repairs? The law doesn't ask for compliance with the new requirements, But of course, when owners are to carry out a major maintenance project, they are welcome to follow the new rules. Next, Mr. Andrew Lam. Thank you, Chair. Moving from being prescriptive to performance-based, it has my support. At the same time, my understanding is that we want to streamline the process so as to enhance quality and efficiency. I just wonder if it is possible to allow professionals or licensed persons to verify their work themselves. When you move from being prescriptive to performance-based, I wonder if you can allow for self-verification or self-accreditation. If this is the case, how are you going to make sure that supervision will be adequate? In your paper, it is said that the design, the proposals, have to be submitted to the authority for approval. Now, if there is a change, what is your consideration? The second point is that in paragraph 4 of your paper, it is said that in future, in the light of the latest developments and technological advancements, there will be changes. We have got sensors. We have got the key data to assist us to check for water leakage under the smart water supply system. So I just wonder if your drainage repair subsidy scheme would cover this as well. Ms. Yu, thank you, Chair. The first question was, if it is a matter of performance-based, whether the building plans will become more complicated and whether it is possible to have self-approval instead of involving the cumbersome approval on the part of the government. Now, for a drainage code, it will be prescriptive in nature. If you just follow the code, then the design would be easy. Whenever we talk about a new building, the buildings department will approve the drainage plans, but we won't cover all the details. We do have precious notes to tell you which parts will have to be vetted by us. They are the fundamental features. For the drainage systems, we are mainly interested in the connection with the public sewers. For the other parts of the drainage system, we will just have a sort of a light touch approach. In other words, the vetting procedures won't be different in future. But then at the end of the day, if it is said that there is a new material, there is a new type of pipes, what we think is that since this is something new and we want to be sure that when new materials, new technologies are used, they can still achieve the same objective, then in this case, I believe that they have to demonstrate to us and they have to get us involved so that we'll vet and approve it. We are also streamlining the application process to assist the industry in making use of new technologies and new materials while not holding up their sort of progress of construction. The other point is about leakage, whether we can apply new technology to detect water seepage and whether this can be sort of covered by the Building Drainage System Repair Subsidy Scheme. I don't think we have got a technology that can carry out automatic detection in relation to water seepage. But then our department is trying out something which is experimental, like using drones or using vertical robots armed with a camera to inspect the externally mounted pipes. Of course, we make use of AI as well. Last year, the report was completed and the conclusion was that the technology was still at the R&D stage, the accuracy is still not yet up to our requirements. It is not yet the same as the outcome that can be achieved by human eye inspection. So we will continue to explore the feasibility to see how we can make better use of technology to check for the health of our pipe work. Next, Mr. Bill Tang. Thank you, Chair. Well, by amending the drainage-related regulations under the Buildings Ordinance, I want to ask this question. Though I know that the new regulations won't apply to the existing buildings, but then for existing buildings, in particular, the old urban buildings in the city, many of them have undergone unlawful alterations. Quite a large number of them have become subdivided units. A building was not supposed to accommodate that many residents. And as a result, the water supply system, the water pressure, the power supply were designed for a smaller size of population instead of the current one. Now, pandemic is with us, and I want to know the views of the administration. Yes, I know you're saying that you will be in the fourth quarter of year 2023 that you present the regulations to us. Do you have a system to supervise the old buildings with a lot of subdivided units and having problems with worn and torn drainage systems? What is your law enforcement status?
Director, for subdivided units, all along the government's view is that we are not going to eradicate all of them. Our main and most important concern is to ensure that they are safe. We will pick out those that are most vulnerable for a large-scale operation. For this year, 100 buildings will be selected, 20 being industrial buildings. What we want to do is to check the overall degree of safety. Upon entry into individual flats, if the pipes are found to be defective, we will also enforce the law on the same occasion. So that would be covered by large-scale operations. And then, as I have said, there might have been connections at numerous points affecting the efficiency and effectiveness of the drainage system, resulting in blockage or backflows, etc. Generally speaking, what we do is that we will act upon receiving a complaint, and then we'll carry out a site visit, and we will ask the building owners to carry out an improvement. We don't have any specific measures as to how we are going to gradually improve the pipework of individual subdivided units. So the approach is mainly acting upon complaints and also covering them while we carry out a large-scale operation. Mr. Tang, of course, for such old buildings, we have got many subdivided units. Generally speaking, we have low-rise buildings having subdivided units. In Shewa Street, I'm not going to name them. Their pipes usually burst frequently. We may have shops on the ground level. They are buildings in Shewa Street. On the lower floors, we have subdivided units. As a result of the existence of subdivided units, there are hygiene problems, and then because of the problems with the pipework, the residents on the upper floors have to bear the external costs as well, and they're complaining. Director, would you like to take this question? I think it goes beyond the scope of today's paper. Basically, as the law stands, well, when it is a case of being unhygienic or the pipes and drains are broken, we can issue an order to ask for a repair. Ms. Choi, if I may also add to the answers.
soon after the start of the pandemic, the administration worked through the AEF. We got funding under the AEF. We came up with an inspection scheme for the pipes and drains on the external walls. The buildings department spent 18 months between starting from June 2020. So we went around the city and we inspected the external walls. We checked to see if the pipes were in order. We didn't gain entry into individual flats, but then we inspected all the buildings that are private buildings exceeding three stories, as well as composite buildings. So it was sort of a visual inspection. And then gradually, for those that have been found to have wrong connection of pipes, then we will, and we took action. In fact, all the orders have been issued.
So we have issued orders for them to make good these drainage and pipes. We understand that some property owners would require assistance, especially those of the three new buildings. So we have been working together with the URA. As the director said, we have the building drainage system repair subsidy scheme. We provide subsidies for the owners. So we have a subsidy of $120,000 to $1 million to assist the property owners to make good their drainage systems. So apart from making good the drainage pipes, they can also enhance their drainage system. So that's why in our proposal, we are saying that if there are measures that can make the pipes better and the ventilation pipes better, if the property owners want to do so, they can make use of the subsidy for such purpose. So we have sort of had a simple inspection done, and we will try to help the property owners concerned. Thank you, Ms. Choi, for your supplement. So we have completed discussion on this agenda item. So thank you, government representatives, for joining us. Now let's move on to the next agenda item. Agenda item 5, a more connected harbour front. So please invite government officials to join us. Members who would like to speak, please press the speak button. So welcome, Ms. Doris Ho, Permanent Secretary for Development, Ms. Nongli Li, Commissioner for Harbour Front, and also Mr. Ching Kit, Senior Engineer of the Development Bureau. So first, I would like to invite the administration to give a PowerPoint presentation to introduce the topic to us. Permanent Secretary. Thank you, Chair. Maybe I'll give a few brief accounts and then I'll pass the mic to Leonie for a more detailed explanation. So for the coming 5 years, we will try to further connect our harbour front. We would like to take this item to this panel. That is because during the last anti-chamber exchange, there have been discussion about the connectivity of the harbour front. And we have a discussion with members, and the members' response are very positive, and they have raised questions for us. They asked, when we try to work on the promenade, it seems that the focus is on Hong Kong Island, and little is done on Kowloon side, but that's not the case. So the commissioner will give us an explanation later on. For the Harbour Front Commission,
Actually, we have tried to develop 73 kilometers of promenade along two sides of the harbor. We have opened 25 kilometers of it in. For the coming 5 years up to 2028, we want to open up another 9 kilometers of the waterfront, making a total of 34 kilometers. And for the 9 kilometers in the coming 5 years to be opened for use, they are mostly located in Kowloon in the Kai Tak development area. When we try to open the developable waterfront, we have also taken into account the need to enhance the public facilities along the waterfront and want to see whether these facilities can be relocated so that we can further open up the waterfront promenade. And we have 30 such kilometers of harbourfront area, and we will continue to work on them, although it is more challenging for us to open up these 30 kilometers of the waterfront. The last point is that we will try to create more and more promenade so that the harbourfront promenade total length will reach 34 kilometers. We also pay a lot of attention to the software. And I hope members would appreciate that for the past few years, we have been testing different models for managing the promenade. And we try to allow the public to enjoy the waterfront with their families and friends. So we will continue efforts on that front. Now I would like to pass the time to Leonie, Commissioner for Harbourfront, for a detailed introduction. Thank you. So I would like to elaborate on the 34 kilometers of waterfront mentioned by the Permanent Secretary and also the 30 kilometers which cannot be developed for the time being. For the 73 kilometers of the waterfront in the Victoria Harbour, 34 kilometers have been opened, and we hope that for the coming 5 years we can open up another 9 kilometers. So you can see the detailed figures on this PowerPoint. And there are also some 4 kilometers which have the potential for development, but their development may be owned by private developers, so the timetable is not available at this stage. Also, another 35 kilometers, they are housing some public facilities like public cargo handling areas, and they may be natural coastlines, or they are developed with private residential premises or commercial blocks. So as the Permanent Secretary said, Kowloon will be the area that we'll be focusing on in the coming 5 years. It runs from Cheung Sha Wan to Yau Tong, stretching a length of 27 kilometers. Of this, about 20 kilometers are developable. Some of them have been opened already. 9.3 kilometers of them have been opened, and we hope that by 2028, 80% of this stretch will be opened and connected for use. First, I will talk about the Yau Tong West Kowloon area. The next PowerPoint, we talk about the Kai Tak area. You can see that this is the Cheung Sha Wan area. In Lai Ying Street, there is a residential project and a hotel development. They will be opened next year and will have a 300-meter promenade. The next one is the open space, and we hope that we will try to enhance the open space dry water flow interceptor area and provide an 80-meter length promenade. For the Tsim Sha Tsui Hong Kam area, we will move to To Kwa Wan preliminary treatment works to Hoi Sam Park extension. So there will be a promenade of about 380 meters. It will be open in phases this year and tomorrow. On the eastern part, that will be the Yau Tong development area. It's a private development project. It will be have a length of 290 meters and will be open in 2023. Now I would like to focus on the Kai Tak area. There will be a number of projects which will be materialized in the coming years. First of all, in this circle area, it is a project of the Housing Society, and it will provide a promenade of about 110 meters to be opened in 2028. This is the Dining Cove. next close to the Kai Tak Sports Park section. It will be a promenade of about 150 meters and another 580 meters near the Kai Tak Metro Park. They will both be open in 2024. For the former Kai Tak runway, there will be an area called D3 Kai Tak Road. It will be a Metro Park section. It will provide a promenade of about 1 kilometer. It has been used and can be opened in 2024. On the both sides of the runway, there will be a total promenade length of 1.9 kilometers on both sides of the runway. Last year, this public open space area has already been used, and for the land to be sold, all the POS will also be opened gradually, progressively within this year. Then we move on to the area, the promenade in front of the new acute hospital, which is close to the children hospital. And then there is also a residential project at 1 to 5 Kai Heng Road. It will provide promenade of 300 meters and 160 meters respectively. The opening time will be 2026 and 28. Moving up to Kwun Tong, there will be a Traping River Cross River Walkway. And then also part of the charcoaling promenade. We expect that certain sections will be open this year, providing 180 meters and 130 meters respectively. For the remaining portion of the charcoaling waterfront promenade, we hope that by 2028 we can provide promenade of about 910 meters linking to Yau Tong area. On the Hong Kong side, on 2025, we hope that after the completion of all these projects, we will be able to provide 13 kilometers of promenade. It will be 280 meters length. For the East Coast Park precinct, we will also provide a promenade of 300 meters. Later this year, we will go to the LegCo for funding support, and we hope that by 2025, we'll be able to complete the works. The other one is about the boardwalk underneath the Island East Corridor. It is a promenade of about 2.2 kilometers, and we hope that it will be open by 2025. For the Chin Wan and Ching Yi area, there will be 5.5 kilometer promenade. They have been opened already. The more familiar one will be the Chin Wan waterfront section. It is completed in... Also, we have completed the anti-cycle track. So I think these areas are mostly open, but we will try to provide enhancement works. For the 35 kilometers which are not developable, we will continue to look at them. To give you an idea, for these 35 kilometers, 7 kilometers is in Kowloon, for example, the new Yau Ma Tei PCWA and also the cement plant. 7 kilometers is 4 kilometers in Hong Kong. They are natural coastlines and also refuse transfer stations. Another 24 kilometers is located in the NT. It is mainly around the Kwai Ching container terminal area. And some of them are being used for industrial purpose like cement plants. So for these non-developable promenades, we will continue to review them. For those which are having government facilities on top, we will try to work with the departments concerned to see whether we can set them back or relocate them or have a pedestrian way conducted. So this is what is happening to the To Kwa Wan transfer station. So that's why the drainage department has provided a pedestrian connection so that people can access the waterfront. Secondly, we also try to look at the ways to connect the pedestrians with the area. For the new Yau Ma Tei PCWA, we are trying to conduct technical studies to see whether we can have a pedestrian path. The pedestrian path may not necessarily be along the coastline, but it will enhance connectivity. Thirdly, we may look at boardwalks and try to connect the promenades on the two sides of the water. One example is the boardwalk under the Iron Eastern Corridor. It connects the promenade sections on Hong Kong Island East. The permanent secretary has said that we have also worked on the software apart from the hardware. So we try to provide some activities. On the recent policies, on the management mode and the placemaking and innovative design, we are all working on that and we want to give people new experiences. One example is that we try to have some shared space in the promenade so that we allow people to have cycling and safe sports there. So we impose a little restriction so that the citizens can enjoy the waterfront freely. So you are now looking at the harbour trail in the Wan Chai area. On the right is the water sports and recreation precinct. So these are the waterfront share space examples. If you can see the duck boats, there are restaurants, floating restaurants and restaurants on land. For Tuen Mun Promenade, it is also a shared use area. We have worked with the local artists, so we try to put in some cartoon characters and installations. So we also have some playing facilities like carts to provide a waterfront with a characteristic. For the eastern part, we have the first barrier reef that is breakwater that is open to the public. And we also have installations with wordings like Victoria Harbour. In the 2022, we have a policy address saying that we want to have around the island trail, which is 60 kilometers long, and to connect the walking trails in the countryside and existing promenades. So this project is being taken forward by the CEDD. They have commissioned designs and hope that in 5 years' time, we can connect 60 kilometers of such promenades and walking trails and make 90% of them for use by the public in the coming 5 years. That's my introduction. Thank you.
Before you speak, I just want to draw your attention to the following. Yesterday, on the 27th of February, we received from Sari Lee a letter to me, and you can take a look of Annex 4. And we've also got a submission. Well, Ms. Lee's letter, as well as the submission from a delegation, have been copied from members. And a copy has been sent to the administration for your reference as well. Earlier today, before lunch, we received from the administration a reply from the administration concerning Ms. Lee's letter. I think a copy has been tabled for your reference. The same has been emailed to members. So please note the relevant papers. Now I open the floor to members. 10 members would like to speak. I will read out the order of your chance to speak. Andrew Lam, Chan Hock Fong, Tang Ka-piu, Edward Leung, Dr. Simon Lee, Lam So Wai, Mrs. Regina Yip, Dr. Ngan Man Yu, Mr. Frankie Yip, and Mr. Leung Man Guang. In that order. 4 minutes each. I would like to start with Mr. Andrew Lam. Thank you, Chair. A more connected waterfront or more connected harbour front. Of course, it is what we have been expecting, and we have to praise the government for the enhancement of our harbour front. A good job. A lot has been achieved. For us to move forward, just want to draw attention to 2 points. An accessible harbour front. Does it mean that you must include the recreational function? When we look at the history of the development of the harbour front, if you address it from the cultural perspective, and when you look at the heritage, Well, I think cargo working is a very important element. How are we going to incorporate this element so that our citizens and even overseas visitors can understand this feature of our city? I think it is something we need to promote. It should be part of our public education. In your future designs, I think this element should be included. It should be sort of expanded. You shouldn't just try to eliminate it. So it's a matter of looking at the function of our harbourfront. While you try to have a more connected harbourfront, I think in future, you have to make sure that the existing operations will still be accommodated. If you need to relocate them, of course, we need to take a positive view. However, in terms of our philosophy, you need to adjust your strategies. Ms. Ho, I'd like to thank the member for his view. I can't agree with you more. In Hong Kong, our harbour has always been a working harbour. On either side of the Victoria Harbour, we still have operations that support our economy, like public cargo working areas, piers, container terminals, etc. All of them are part of our history and the history of the Victoria Harbour. Yes, I do agree with you. We should not aim at eradicating all of them, but at the same time, I don't think we should rule out the possibility. Let's be more pragmatic. Sometimes it is not that easy to find a site to relocate them. Now, the members' view was to be more sort of accommodating, so that while the citizens can enjoy the harbourfront, the harbourfront operations can be kept. I'm sure this is one of the directions that we can explore. Thank you. Next, Mr. Chen Hock Fung. Thank you, Chair. For the past decade, we have seen beneficiary development of the harbourfront. I was on the membership of the Harbourfront Enhancement Commission. I'm glad to see that the harbourfront is available for public enjoyment. And I need to praise the government. This is quite different from the LCSD. In the past, the LCSD would tell you what the 100 not-to-do things that you need to bear in mind. For the new designs, I welcome it because it is injecting new elements into our city life. There are a few points that I want to share with the administration. Well, for the waterfront of Kennedy Town, I just wonder if we can have boardwork that is hanging from cantilevers. Currently, there are just too many people standing next to the waters, right next to the traveling vehicles to take pictures. So I think it is said that this point will be addressed. So please look at the case of people taking pictures in a very dangerous position just off Merton. I just wonder if you can be more innovative and think outside the box. Can we not have a sort of footbridge above the waterfront operations, so that we can have a view of the harbour while not obstructing the harbourfront operations? Another concern is about the Shun Tak Centre. Again, the pedestrian connection is lost there. Can we not have a wider footpath so as to accommodate the pedestrians? So I urge the administration to take care of that. So hardware aside, let me come to the software. I think we don't have too many activities at the harbor front. It may have to do with the pandemic. But recently, activities held at the Kennedy Town harbor front have been subject to a lot of restrictions. We try to attract the young people, but then it is a rule that we cannot receive payment when we carry out activities on government land. I hope there can be some relaxation so the young people can run some business there. And then a word on the catering industries. After taking a leisurely walk along the harbourfront, it is very difficult for you to get something to eat or to drink. Mr. Chen has been giving us a lot of valuable comments in different capacities. Just now you talked about the fact that people were taking photographs by standing by the roadside of Merton. I think it is indeed something we have got in mind. We hope that we can have something like the boardwalk under the Island Eastern Corridor. It will be short, just about 200 meters. We are reviewing the protection of harbor ordinance. Let's hope that small-scale harbor enhancement projects could be allowed under the ordinance. I noted your point about PWCAs. And then for accessibility, in order to make it interesting, as Mr. Chen has said, maybe we can build a footbridge, and provided that it is safe, we can allow citizens to watch the operations of PWCAs. And then for the case of Shun Tak Center and your proposal to widen the footpath, yes, we will relay your message. Software is needed to make sure that the hardware will be put to good use. For us, in the harbor office, we have already given an undertaking. Every year, we will be hosting at least 30 activities or 30 events at the harbor front. Other than the activities, yes, the member was saying that we need to be more flexible so that people would have a freer hand in organizing the activities. Next, Mr. Bill Tang, Chair, for the past 10 years, for the harbourfront enhancement and public participation, public enjoyment, I think we have seen good results and we should commend the administration for that. It is to the sort of envy of our neighbouring cities and they would like to learn from us. It will be excellent if we can cover all the 72 kilometers of our coastline. It will take a long time. My constituency is in Kowloon East. There are two tables in the paper. There will be 7 km more before 2028 and then 4 km more after that. We'll have harbourfront enhancements in Yau Tong and Cha Kwa Ling. So, for Kowloon East, with the efforts mentioned in the two tables, does it mean that we can start from Kwun Tong Waterfront Promenade and go all the way to Lei Yu Moon to have a seafood dinner? Or will the promenade be truncated or interrupted by private properties? Can we have a sort of continuous promenade in Kowloon East? Can we go all the way to Lei Yu Moon? And then for items 8 and 9, there will be 4 more kilometers after the year 2028. 1.5 km or 1.4 km of the promenade will be located in Yau Tong. It this pending redevelopment by private developers, can we not do something to make sure that priority will be given to the promenade? It is quite a long stretch, measuring 1.24 km. You also talked about amending the law. Our former colleague, Ms. Alice Mack, this asked for an amendment to the Protection of Harbour Ordinance, which should accommodate reclamation that benefits the residents. Now, you say that you may want to build boardwalk as a solution. Are there other available tools? And then another question is about the management approach. The management approach is different from that of the LCSD. We want to promote small businesses. Can we not allow vendors to sell food while riding on a bicycle? So can we not have food being sold by cyclists?
Permanent Secretary, can you take the other questions first? We'll talk about the Protection of Harbour Ordinance at our next meeting. Yes, Chair. Mr. Tang has asked whether it is possible to walk all the way from Kwun Tong to Lei Yu Mun for a seafood meal. If we look at this map, we can start from Traping River Cross River section. Please look at Appendix 1. A11, 12 and 13, it is stated that it will be opened by 2028. So through the public works program and also the VTC, they will have a new campus there. So we will collaborate with them so as to make good the waterfront in front of the VTC new campus. So when you move on to B8, this is the Yarrow area. This is the Yau Tong Bay Comprehensive Development Area. So the majority of this area is owned by private developers. And the developers are discussing with the government about land premium. So we will try to reflect in the lease concern that they have to provide a promenade of 15 meters. So this is the yellow area, but I cannot tell you about the timing at this stage because it depends on amendment to the leases. And then we move on to Yau Tong Tong Yun Street. Most of them are actually private residential developments. Some of them are common facilities like pumping stations, etc. So gradually, these areas will also be connected. If I remember correctly, then I think we'll move to the inner harbour of Lei Yu Mun. So the Tourism Commission has a works project there, and it will be able to lead us to Sam Ka Village. Sorry, Mr. Tang, your time is up. And for the review of the Protection of Harbour Ordinance, it will be discussed at the next meeting. But if time is on our side, we'll ask a permanent sector supplement. Next, Mr. Edward Leung. Chairman, for the Hong Kong North Promenade, I am in support of that. It is now 13 kilometers long. It moves all the way from Shao Ki Wan to Sai Wan. But there is still an issue because it is sort of truncated in the middle. It moves from Chai Wan to Shao Ki Wan because for the section that is truncated, it is occupied by private development. The CE has mentioned in the policy address is that he wants to press ahead with the Round the Island Trail, and he hopes that the trail will be around the Hong Kong Island and it will enhance our living environment. So I would like to know whether it is possible to connect the whole of the Hong Kong Island, particularly the northern part. Actually, back in 2021, there is a study of the coastal area
near the Hung Fa Chin area. There will be a staircase leading to the slopes, and then it will be connected to the rest of the promenade. So I would like to ask the administration, will you study that? It is proposed back in 2012. Now the CE said that he would like to push for the Round the Island Trail. So will you look at that again?
Thank you, Chair.
Permanent Secretary, thank you, Mr. Leung, for your suggestion. The answer is yes. The section that you've talked about is the section that we want to connect, but there is some difficulty because it involves some natural coastline. And some time ago, we have actually conducted a study. At that time, we were thinking of building a boardwalk so that it will run from Shao Ki Wan to Hung Fa Village. But during that time, when we have the public consultation, the residents there object to the proposal. But that was some 10 years ago. But as you have said, because you are now trying to push for the Round the Island Trail, we will look at this section again to see whether we can come up with a solution that will be acceptable to the local residents and to connect the promenade. Thank you. We hope that we can connect all the way from Sai Wan to Siu Sai Wan. Let's work together on that. Yes, I think we all want to enhance the continuity of the promenade. There are now certain sections which have yet to be connected, and we are concerned about that. I hope the administration will continue to work on those. As Ms. Larry Lee, she has also pointed out the same concern in her letter. Next, Mr. Simon Lee. Well, Chairman, like the former four colleagues, I would like to congratulate the government for making our promenade more enjoyable. I have actually visited a promenade on Hong Kong Island and Kowloon Sai to prepare for attendance at this meeting. I think the section outside Central and Admiralty is good. But for certain sections which have been opened earlier, some problems have occurred. The first point that I walk about is the Hong Ham area towards the Tim Sha Tsui section. So that section has been opened for some 10 years. It was open when the bypass was open. But the railings there seems to be rather makeshift. They are like some steel railings which are painted white, but with the passage of time, they have become rusty. So please look at those facilities. So they are not so pretty as the other sections of the promenade. So moving towards the Tsim Sha Tsui area, it will be close to the Hong Kong railway station. For the Chim Tung area section, it is very long, and I see that for the pavements, some of them are dilapidated. And I think you need to carry out some maintenance work, but they don't look very nice, although they have been repatched. So please don't just focus on connectivity, but also focus on those sections which have been opened for quite some time, and you have to touch up with these sections. Some of them do require maintenance. This is my comments, no questions. Permanent Secretary on maintenance and repair. Well, thank you, Mr. Lee, for the reminder. We do notice that for the Kowloon Sai, the Tsim Sha Tsui to Hong Kong section was opened quite early as compared to the other sections of promenades. So there are certain areas which require maintenance. We'll go back and look at the two places that you've just mentioned. For the Harbourfront Office, what is your participation in respect of these issues? If you allow a certain department or organization to manage the promenade, so what will happen? You want to open it first before enhancing them, but now it seems that we are having maintenance and repair problems. So we hope that it will be better than before. It seems that they are not so good these days as compared to the past. Commissioner, For the different sections of the promenades, they are actually managed by different departments and repaired by different departments. Some are under the purview of my office, but most of them are under the purview of others like LCSD or Highways Department. So different departments are working on that, but I do have a coordination role. For the sections that have been mentioned by members, I will take them up with the department's concern. So please look at the situation regularly. Otherwise, you will give us the impression that certain sections of the promenade are nice, but others are not. Mr. Lee, I think it's not just maintenance. We try to open the sections first and then provide enhancements. But I think for some sections, you just open it, but you haven't taken out enhancement works. So it gives people the impression that some of the facilities, like the railings, are rather temporary and makeshift. So Development Bureau and Harbourfront Office, please take that into account. Next, Ms. Lim Shou Wai. Well, the Victoria Harbour is a valuable natural asset for Hong Kong, and I welcome the government to proactively try to build a new promenade that can be for shared use. Mr. Tang has pointed out for Kowloon East, there is a blockway going all the way to Lee Yu Moon. I have a question for Cheung Kwan O area. Will you consider providing a promenade linking Cheung Kwan O with the other areas? The Cheung Kwan O promenade is 1.6 kilometers. If you connect that with Teo Keng Ling, there are people who may come for cycling and other activities. But for the Yau Tong CDA, it is included in the plan already. So for Kowloon East, the coastal areas, will you try to see if the Cheung Kwan O Coastal Park can be linked to Cha Kwo Ling and Sam Kha Chin area? Would it be possible to do so? So that means you can walk from Cheung Kwan O all the way to Lei Yu Moon. Also, to further enhance the harbourfront, can we link to the Kai Tak area and even Chin Wan area? So do you need to have simple mechanism to be put under the Protection of Harbour Ordinance so as to enhance our waterfront? I think for Yim Tin in Sam Chan, they do have boardwalks which are along the coast, and they are used for tourism purpose. But of course, we have to protect the waterfront when we carry out such works. For the sections of the promenade which are developed earlier, will you be reinvigorating them? Would you be putting in new uses, like, for example, small cars selling food? Will you consider providing floating restaurants or some arts elements along the coast area? Permanent Secretary? Well, thank you for your suggestions. Well, the Harbourfront Office, it looks at the area according to a geographical area. For the Kowloon East area, it goes all the way up to Lei Yu Moon. But then, of course, we should not be bound by geographical boundaries. And we should try to think of means to better connect the promenade on Kowloon side. Well, during the exchanges with members before, we've been talking about Cheung Kwan O 132, 137 areas, how to develop them. For 132 area, we want to have reclamation so as to accommodate public facilities. There is a hill in the 132 area, a cemetery is there. There are people who actually walk there for hiking purpose. So can we make use of that opportunity so that we can move from Cheung Kwan O South along the hill and all the way move to Sam Kha Chin? A member has also suggested that amendments to the Protection Harbour Ordinance would need to be explored. Now I would like to elaborate a bit more. As the chairman has said, for the next panel meeting, we will consult members on amendments to the ordinance. Our current thinking is that we want to preserve the Victoria Harbour. We will not conduct reclamation along the Victoria Harbour lightly. If there are major reclamation works, although we don't see the need for such at the moment, even if there is the need to do so, we would set a very high bar for doing so. They would have to justify for overriding public interest in order to do so. But for the minor works, these works can let the industries operate better along the harbour and can also allow citizens to enjoy the harbour. We do agree that we should introduce a simple mechanism whereby these minor works can be conducted. So we'll talk about that in detail at the coming panel meeting. Your last point is about using small carts to sell food or floating restaurants. We will think about that. One suggestion that we have been receiving frequently is that people hope that along the promenade, there will be some kiosks selling food, beverages, and snacks, not necessarily big restaurants. So they can be sold on mobile vehicles like tricycles or bicycles. And we hope that the facilities can serve the citizens enjoying the promenade. We will take all that into consideration.
Next, Mrs. Regina Yip. First of all, may I check with the Permanent Secretary? You said that the harbourfront is 73 km long, 25 have been opened, and 35 left are not developable. In other words, we cannot touch them because either they are private properties or we have to use the site for public cargo working. It is good to enhance the harbourfront for the public enjoyment. Does it mean that you are left with 13 km long harbourfront to enhance? We have opened 25 km. In the next 5 years, 9 more. In other words, 34 altogether. And then 4 kilometers length will probably be made available through private development or as a result of the lease conditions of land sale. In other words, 38 in total, adding 4 to 34. And then there are 35 together, they come up to, they add up to 73. As some members have said, we are not able to relocate the container terminals or the appropriate cargo working areas. But then for certain public facilities like pumping stations or drainage facilities of the government, our colleagues will liaise with the relevant works departments like the drainage services department to check if we can set back the facility and then we can open the harbour front to the public. Mention has been made about the case of Kennedy Town. Now, the harbour front is right next to the waters, and the promenade is also next to the road, and people may have to brush with the travelling vehicles. So it is wondered whether we can use boardwalk to provide access to the harbour front among the 35 km. Of harbourfront. Can you not be brief? Roughly speaking, how much will still be developable? And then you have got $6.5 billion available. Do you need to get fresh funding? We have got $6.5 billion. I believe that he can see us through the 5-year program to add another 9 km long harbour front. Yes, you can complete your task, right? Yes. But for the 35 non-developable harbour front, we may have to incur additional expenditure. In other words, $6.5 billion for how long in terms of the harbourfront? Who can take this question? You can just give us a rough estimate. $6.5 billion for 10 kilometers. It's rather expensive, right? I hope when you call tenders again, you have to make sure that since you have already gained experience, you can ask the contractors to write on your experience and quote a lower price so that you don't have to come back to get extra funding. You've said that you have been very imaginative. You have the fenceless approach. You have also got the water sports and recreation present. All of them are good ideas, but then there's still a risk element. Visitors will flock to the waterfront. For the fence-free design, will it be accident-prone? What about young children playing around there? And what about littering? If there are just too many people, then what can we do about the littering issue? For the outlying island piers, over the weekends, they are really very busy. And then there have been complaints about people not following the order. Can you share with us the experience at Fortress Hill? I think again, it is fence-free design to make sure that it is water-friendly. Well, we have got some safety devices, like the life buoys, and we have got round-the-clock inspection or patrolling by our security guards. And there is a regular cleaning carried out by the FHD. On days when the weather is poor, then we close the breakwater. Who is responsible for the management? In most cases, it is the LCSD that looks after our promenade. For the harbour office, it does take part in the management of other sections of the harbour front. We are interested in trying out innovative management approaches. Next, Dr. Anan Yu. Three questions from me. For the Hong Kong Island Promenade, I think all of us know that it is very good. But then for the one on Kowloon Peninsula, people say that it is not continuous enough. How come that you don't have something similar to that on the Hong Kong Island? For the case on Hong Kong Island, we are quite clear about the themes. But the same is not true for Kowloon. You don't have a similar blueprint. In the case of Kowloon, when you get a site, then you say that let's turn it into a park. Like in the case of Chakwaling, when the VTC is to be built, then a large lawn will be provided. Or there is a small site available, again, you turn it into a park. And in some cases, we have got private developers now providing the public open space. And then you have got all sorts of ideas, like the diversified, vibrant and harmonious harbour front. You have the shared at the experimental grounds as well as the harbour front shared space. You're going to hold 30 events. I think it is only for the one in Hong Kong that you have the pop-up seasonal decorations. For the other sites in Kowloon, we don't have any activities at all. Does it mean that whenever it is managed by the LCSD, the Harbour Office would refrain from rejuvenating it? So is it really a diversified and vibrant harbour front, or is it just a truncated harbour front? in an answer to Bill Tang's question, that is, walking from Chui Ping River cross path to Lei Yu Moon, it is said that when two projects are ready, then it will be continuous. I'm afraid it won't really be continuous because there is a point where you cannot go walk through. I just want to say that we're supposed to end at 5:15. Two more members have indicated they wish to speak, so I suggest that we extend the meeting by no more than 15 minutes. So, Ms. Ho, would you like to give an answer? Thank you. I'd like to thank the member for his suggestions. Well, I don't think you should say that in Kowloon we don't have a planning study at all. Well, in the case of Kai Tak, for the promenade, the layout design, as well as the landscaped deck at the tip of the runway, how they're going to interface. Well, in fact, we put in a lot of planning efforts when we carried out the Kai Tak development study. For the activities, whether there are much fewer of them on the current side, I can't actually give an answer off the cuff, but I'll go back to collate the figures and share the information with you. Thank you for your reminder. We'll make sure that in the future when we organize activities, we will try to have we'll emphasize both the Hong Kong Island and Kowloon. In Kai Tak development, there are more and more public open spaces being commissioned. And then for Hong Kong Urban Park, I think it will be commissioned next year. So they will present opportunities for us to organize activities. Sorry, I think she misunderstood me. For the Harbour Office activities, why is it that for Kwun Tong Promenade, under the management of the LCSD, as well as the landscaped garden under the DSD, are not to benefit from the activities organized by the Harbour Office? Please bear in mind this point. Yes, we will bear in mind this concern. We shouldn't be sort of restricted just because it falls into another region. Even if a venue is not under our jurisdiction, I don't think we should be prevented from organizing activities. What about your point saying that there is a point where the promenade would not be sort of continuous? There's a red dot on the map. Yes, it is a pumping station belonging to the DSD. We'll talk to the DSD to see if it can be set back so that the harbour front can become accessible. Next, Mr. Frankie Yick. Of course, I can understand that the people of Hong Kong would very much want to have more harbour front available for their enjoyment. But I need to speak on behalf of my constituency. We need to bear in mind that we need land for PWCAs. When Professor Anthony Cheung was the secretary for transport housing, he said that we must have the public cargo working areas. You need them for your daily necessities. You need them for the construction materials like sand and aggregates, etc. So please don't forget that. Many members who spoke made very good points. That is, we need to be inclusive, we should be tolerant, and we can coexist with the existing operations, like building a footbridge across the facilities, so that while we can walk along a continuous promenade, we won't be obstructing the existing facilities. At Lung Kwu Tan, we are going to have reclamation. At the refrigerated terminal area, again, there will be replanning, so perhaps more berths will be made available there. In other words, PWSCs can be relocated. It is not a must that they have to stay in situ, but make sure that there are enough berths to accommodate their operation. I'm sure we can have a discussion to see whether berths or the PWCAs that are in the town can be relocated to new areas. I just want to share with you my concerns. We can't just go after harbourfront enhancement by sacrificing the PCWAs. Ms. Ho, yes, the concern is noted. Yes, for the public cargo working areas, they are important for our daily lives. We won't lightly drive them away without a proper relocation plan. For the harbourfront people, we always give sort of emphasis to this point. For the new Yang Ma Tei facility, for the new Yang Ma Tei public cargo working area that will be available soon, we try to provide for a pedestrian connection without jeopardizing the operation.
Next, Mr. Lung Man Kwong. Thank you, Chair. First of all, I will talk about the past. I remember when I first joined the service of serving the community back in 07-08, we think that we would hoping that it would be possible to walk from Sam Shui Po to the West Kowloon District and then on to Hong Kam and the Kai Tak area and also the Lee Yuen Wun for a seafood meal. That was our wish some 10 years ago, and I can see that the Development Bureau is working hard to achieve that. Especially for the Yang Ma Tei public cargo working area, they are working on an inland pedestrian path that will connect the Sam Shui Po Tai Kwok Chui area with the West Kowloon District. I know they are working hard on that, but I think from Tai Kwok Chui to the cultural area is not sufficient. We hope that we can also walk from Sam Shui Po to the West Kowloon Cultural District. We will pass a lot of wharves there and other facilities. I hope we can try to follow the example of the Yang Ma Tei PCWA so that the pedestrian way can be put a bit more inland rather than close to the coastline. We can see that from Wai Yip Street to the FEHD facility and Hoi Fan Road. First of all, the road is not connected. There are wide barbed wires, and also the environment is not ideal. So I hope you can beautify the pedestrian walkway so that you try to remove the wire fences so that we can move from Lai Ying Street all the way to Hoi Fai Street and the Cultural District. Is this one worth exploring? This is the first point. Secondly, about the Lai Ying Street promenade, I have written to the departments concerned. You can see that there is a roundabout in Lai Ying Street, and you can see that it is only a very bare pedestrian walkway. And there is also a gradient of several meters. I have written to Highways Department because it is now under the Highways Department. I asked whether any beautification work can be done. Can we provide some public open space? For example, exit B of the occurrence to, and also provide accessible access. But the Highways Department told me that it is only responsible for maintenance and repair. And it is said that it is outside their purview. And they haven't even said that they will refer to the relevant department. So that's why I have written to the secretary. Because now you are talking about connectivity. If you do not provide the sufficient ancillary facilities, then the promenade will be useless. The citizens will find it difficult to get there, and you don't have accessibility for persons with disabilities. So I hope that the Bureau will look into all these details, and we will all take an extra mile so as to enhance connectivity of the promenade.
Well, thank you, Mr. Lung, for your suggestions. You mentioned that for Changsha Wan, the wholesale market, wholesale food market, you're asking whether we can follow the example of Yamate and we produce a pedestrian path more inland. We'll take that into account. On the second point, I think connectivity does not just cover the promenade. We are also trying to look at how to encourage citizens to go from MTR stations to the waterfront. So this is one of our objectives. And the Harbour Office colleagues will try to coordinate the necessary work. So I think we'll go back and liaise with the departments concerned. So for this agenda item, I think members have spoken on the topic. To complete discussion of this agenda item, I want to make a declaration that I'm actually a member of the Harbourfront Commission. I think for the citizens and the members, they all have expectations of the Harbour Office. We know that for Division of Labour, the Harbour Office may not have sufficient resources for undertaking all issues related to the harbour front and the promenade. But I hope that the Harbour Office will play a more active coordinating role. So can you do a bit more on that? So I hope Development Bureau would provide support for the Harbour Office. I think we have a thorough discussion of this topic today, and we have completed discussion of this item. So thank you, Permanent Secretary and Commissioner and Mr. Ng for joining us. Now we move on to item 6 of the agenda, AOB. I don't have any AOB. If members don't have any other businesses to raise, I'll call the meeting to a close. Thank you.